my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the wave when oceans rise, my soul rests in your embrace, for I am grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. My feet may fail if fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now. Rise, my soul rests in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made strong. Call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul rests in your embrace, for I am yours and you. And I will call upon your name, keep my eyes above the waves, my soul rests in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine.
technical difficulties. This is a new song. This song's called Won't Stop Now. If you listen to the chorus, it says, your presence is an open door. It says, we want you, Lord, like never before. I love the first one in this song. It says, I give you glory for all you've brought me through, and now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. So who can say that they're just ready for whatever Christ has in store? Like, I know that my ways are wicked, and I know that his are better than mine. I know his ways are much, much better than mine are. So I am ready for whatever he wants to do in my life. I am ready because I know that my path that I want to do leads to destruction. I may have a happy life now, but I'm not going to get a good reward at the end. Let's sing this song together. Help on this one again, because I didn't hear nobody. It's a new song. It's okay. Can you help me out on this one? I heard like three people. Come on. Let's worship.
Jesus. songs I sing for all that you've done for me.
If you have your Bible, please turn with me to Matthew 22. We finally got out of Matthew 21, so man, that was a long time coming. But we jump into another parable, and it's another great parable, and it's finishing off. Chapter and verses were put there for our understanding, so we could understand and navigate through the Bible. So I believe this was just a continuous path that Jesus was telling these religious leaders. But he's talking about this wedding feast, and as you can see our slide, this wedding feast, you're invited. We're all invited to that wedding feast, and we'll see what that looks like here in a second. But let's go before and let's read this passage together. Starting in verse 1, it says, "And again, Jesus spoke to them in parables," and this is his religious leaders. "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited invited to those the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I've prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business. While the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned the city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you can find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, good, bad, both bad and good, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came into look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into outer darkness. In the place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen.'" So it's pretty self-explanatory. But I want to look at what this feast looks like, this wedding feast that God himself is putting on. How many of you have been to weddings? Well, I think we've all been to different types of weddings. Do you like the wedding or do you like the reception better? Many people like the reception because there's food. This week I was looking into extravagant weddings. And it's amazing to see how much people spend on their wedding. I thought $500 for my wedding was a lot, but I got to see hundreds of thousands of dollars being spent on weddings. And I'm like, for one day? As I looked into it, you look at the Kardashian weddings, there's like over a few million. Then I came across, you remember Princess Diana and Charles' wedding? It cost them a whopping $42 million for one day. $42 million. That's all of our money combined. We'd never see that in a lifetime combined. But they spend it in a day. Crazy what these weddings and this big extravagant thing can turn out to be, this wedding feast. But think about it. You plan this huge event, and the next thing is, what do? Who do we invite? That's the biggest. Who do we invite? Who do we not want there? Do we want the suegros there? Nope, I'm just kidding. We have to invite the suegros because it's going to cost you something. But you need to invite who to invite, who not to invite. God forbid you forget Tia Eloisa, in the process, because then everybody's mad at you because you forgot that person. You guys ever have to deal with that? Who do you invite, who don't you invite? There's some people that will make the whole wedding spoiled, and you don't want them there. So there's people that you don't want there, if we're honest. But then you send them with this card, this invitation, this RSVP, right? I don't even know. Yeah, it's a weird name, but RSVP is just to let them know that you're coming, right? But you also give instructions on that, where it's at, what times it's at. You don't want a person come in halfway into the wedding, you know what I mean? Or come in sweats, you know what I mean? You're here in the wedding in sweats, bro, come on. You know what I mean? So you have to have the attire, you have everything on a card. So everybody's in understanding, right? One year, Sam and I threw a Christmas party for for our company. We sent out 100 invites, and it was different subcontracts, different people that we dealt with. So we sent out, and we got 75 responses back, 75 RSVPs. So with that, we were able to order how much food. So we got all of that. We got rented a hall, set up the tables, decorated, you know, set everything up. The DJ, we had the DJ come in, set up all some fancy 80s tunes, you know. The Rick James, the Gap Band type thing, the boo, boo, you know, the 80s, whoever knows all of this type of, might throw out a hip now, but the food was spread out. Everything was ready. And then the time came when the guests were supposed to arrive. And we waited and waited and waited. Five people showed up. Out of 75, five people showed up to that. Talk about a sad evening. I enjoyed the people that were there, but I was hurt because everybody had RSVP'd, and then they got busy doing other things, and they just left us floating. I've never done that since. And it was a hurtful thing to be able to put on something like that and then to be left like that. It was a crazy thing that people will get busy doing other things and forget about something that they've committed to. Sadly enough, that's what we're going to uncover this morning. Some of the same things happen. People are invited to this wedding feast, but they never show up. It's another parable that Jesus is going to present to these people so they can understand exactly what he's telling them. He started off in the last chapter describing in parables, starting with the two sons. What happened with the two sons? Then he went into the vineyards, the wicked servants or the wicked tenants. Now he's telling them once again, so they are clear in an understanding what he's trying to tell them. When, if you want to learn something, it's repetition. You go over it and over and over and over it. And that's what he's doing. So they can understand exactly what he's doing and what he's trying to tell them. As we unfold this morning, I hope that we can see what God is trying to offer us this morning. What we see in this wedding feast and how does it apply to our own lives. So as we begin to unpack it, in verse 1 and 2, he says, and again, Jesus spoke to them, talking about these religious leaders, to them in parables. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. So this is that comparison. As I told you, these parables are earthly stories with heavenly meaning. So he's comparing this. This is what would happen. You know, the marriage of a king's son would be a great thing at any era. It was a great thing. It often raises the questions of who's going to be invited to the feast and who's going to be left out. Those in the lower classes didn't expect to be invited, but the upper class did, you know what I mean? I'm something. However, the parable approaches the question of what happens when the guests don't show up? What's plan B, basically? So in verse 3, he continues, and God sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. If you recognize back in the time of kings, of these kingdoms, when a king offered a decree, when he told a decree, you usually did it. If you didn't follow through with the decree, what usually happened? It lopped off your head, or you got in prison. That was a decree. So here they're playing a dangerous game for not wanting to come. So they'll usually end up having to pay the consequences for it. Here we get to see God's people, his servants, his prophets going to the chosen Israel, his people, and giving them this invitation. In those days, there was two invitations usually given. One to let you know it was coming, and then a second one to follow up and say, okay, it's about here. It's like a reminder on your phone. I have like 3 reminders on my phone, so I know that this is the day, but then I have 2 reminders after that. And that's what's happening. The first one lets you know, the second one, here it's coming. And you know, it could have been a joyous time for a wedding. A Jewish wedding can last up to a week, and most of them are a week long, so you better have a lot of grub to be able to hold on for a week. You get tired of your suegros hanging out, you know what I mean? So in verse 4 it says, Again, he sent other servants saying, tell those who are invited, see, I've prepared my dinner, my oxen, my fat calves. They have been slaughtered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. So think about this. The table's set, this big, huge table. He had killed his fatted calves. He's got this meat. He's got all of this stuff spread out. The bread and butter's on the table, but there's no guests. There's nobody showing up. I don't know about you. Have you ever invited like family over? You prepare this big meal, and then the time shows up, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait. And what is the longer you wait, the more your blood pressure goes up because the food is now getting cold. It's like, bro, you guys are supposed to be here already. So this, I get to see what's going on here. But it says in verse 5, but they paid no attention and went off to his farm, another to his business. They paid no attention to invitation. They were too busy with other things. It wasn't because they couldn't come, it's that they didn't want to come to the wedding feast. Everyone had an excuse. I got to do this. How tragic, though, to have an excuse when you've been invited to a wedding. To be offered a blessing of God and refuse because of the draw to other things. If we look at even our lives in general, men and women alike, carnal men love carnal things. What happened is they blew off their RSVP. Many believe that God's purposes in their life are secondary to their own life. God is always second. Let me live my life first, and then your stuff is second. And that's what happens here. It's just, but to think about it, those of you, if you guys have investments, how much do you get out of an investment if you don't put anything into it? How much can you draw off your investment if you don't ever deposit anything into it? When you're plowing a garden, when you're tending the fields, what do you get out of it if you just sit on the couch and never weed it? If you never water it, what happens? It begins to die. They flat out refused to attend. In fact, they took it to another level. Here it says that being disrespectful, even killing the king's messengers. So we see that in verse 6, it says, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. God sent the prophets to these people to ask them to turn to repentance and turn back to God. That's what was happening, into obedience. But instead of listening to the prophets, they would often kill them to silence them. Why? Why would they silence them? It's affecting my lifestyle. Look at the prophets that were going out there and say, turn from your evil ways. There were all these crazy things going on. He says, turn back to God. Turn from your evil ways. And what did they do? They would kill him. Look at Stephen, the martyr. They killed him. Paul, they stoned him, or even Stephen as well. You get to see these people over time, even Jeremiah, they stripped naked in the streets. They did that to God's people, and he just wanted, as we've been reading in Hosea, a relationship with them. But if you think about it, God is a bummer to those that are living in sin. They don't want to hear it. I want to live my own way. You know, over time, God has tried and tried over time to bring people back to him. As I think he's done with us, he's called our name over and over and over when we start to drift off. Hey, when are you going to come back? He brings people into your life to tell you, hey, when are you going to come back? He still does that. But sometimes it's the same refusal. I'm too busy for you right now, maybe someday. Have you ever heard that? Someday, maybe, I'll come to you. And it's crazy. That's a tragic thing. The Lord even said in John 13:34, he tells us, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones God's messengers, how often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen protects her chicks beneath her wings, but you wouldn't let me. You pushed me away. I wanted you close to me, but you pushed me away. Then how do we push him away? It's by doing our own thing, wanting our own lifestyle. God's stuff is secondary. But look at what happens in verse 7. The king was angry and he sent his troops and destroyed the murderers and burned their city. What were they expecting? Well, God's a loving God. He's a merciful God. But he also is one of judgment. You know, the king's payback against these murders, as we seen last time in Jerusalem at 70 AD, he burned the city and killed the people. What you think about is the Roman Emperor Vespasian thought he was sending his armies against the Jews, but he was unconsciously working out the eternal purpose of the Most High God. As Vespasian thought he was going to go and conquer something, he was being used as an instrument of God to do God's will and purpose, to get a hold of the judgment of the people. God is patient with us, really patient, more than I would be. Even in 2 Peter 3:9, most of us know this passage. It said, the Lord isn't really slow being slow about his promise, as some think. No, he's being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But does God's patience wear out? He's long-suffering, but does his patience wear out? We see it many times in Scripture. At one point, it's full and you're done. Now it's judgment. Now there's no turning back. You're over the edge. God's patience is lengthy, but it's not endless. Think about this. God, in the days of Noah, he sent Noah to preach repentance and people to come back to him. And what happened? He told them over and over and over. What did they do? They mocked him. They laughed at him. Till what happened? The door closed on the ark and the flood came. Judgment was started. Was there knocking on the door? Hey, now let me in. Did they let anybody back in? It was over. The judgment had started. And that's what, at one point, it ends. It starts. But before God usually, all the time, before he pronounces this judgment, he often allows time before this judgment starts. And he warns us over and over. But he won't leave the guilty unpunished. They will have their day. Hebrews 10:29-31 tells us, just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God and have treated the blood of the covenant, which had made us holy, as if it were common and holy and unholy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit who brings God's mercy to us. For we know the one who said, I will take revenge, I will pay them back. He also said, the Lord will judge his own people. It's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. It's a serious thing. And what these people did is pushed it off. So in verse 8, he said to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main roads, into the wedding feast, and invite to the wedding feast as many as you can find. And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. So what was happening here is we get to see, is even in the last chapter, God is taking this invitation away from the Jews. And he's giving it to the repentant Jews and to the Gentiles now, you and I, that are not Jewish descent. He's telling them, go out into the nook and crannies of society. Find as many as you can and invite them. So that's what they did. And it just shows that God's love and compassion for his people. He wants everyone to come in that are invited. Hey, come in. Look at all that I've prepared for you. But the question is, will we come? Or will we be too busy with other things that when he does come? So what he's doing is he goes out and just grab whoever. Think about you and I going downtown and just gathering. Hey, we have a big feast going on. Come and gather everybody. Does he say to pick and choose? He doesn't say to pick and choose. He says grab everybody. Pull everybody in. I want everybody to come. It's the tares growing along with the wheat. It's the wheat and the chaff laying on the same floor. It's the dross mingled with the precious gold. The goats with the sheep. It's the fish of every kind, both good and bad. He's bringing everybody in. He's bringing everybody into the feast. But look at what verse 11 through 14 tells us. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man with no wedding garment. But that was in sweats. I don't know if it was in sweats, but he didn't have a wedding garment. He wasn't dressed for the occasion. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And it says that he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot, tie him up, and cast him into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. Ever seen the signs in a restaurant that say, no shirt, no shoes, no service? You got to have those things to make it in. Acting while I have those and you don't have a shirt on, or you don't have the garments to get in there, you're not going to get in. The garment here that he's talking about symbolizes that we have been forgiven our sins and they have been covered by Jesus Christ. That's the garment you and I will present before him. That's how he's going to notice if you're there. You're going to stand out like a sore thumb. What happened is he gathered everybody in and he offered them this gift of repentance and to trust in Jesus Christ. And those that didn't, he noticed because they didn't have a covering. That's how he's going to distinguish you and I. When we stand before him, hey, you don't have a garment on. You don't have my son's covering on you. That's what's going to set us apart. This is Jesus' way of teaching inadequacy of self-righteousness, that we can't get there on our own. We must have the right attire to be in the feast. Yes, he's invited every make, model, and color. But unless you have the covering, you won't make it in. It's those of us that trust in Jesus Christ. God is providing a covering for our sins since the beginning. If you remember back, way back in Adam and Eve's time, as they walked in the garden, they sinned. And what did they do? They felt naked. So what did they do? Got fig leaves, remember? And they cut them, they covered themselves. Then the Lord says, what are you doing? What's this? But what did he have to do? He had to kill animals. There had to be a sacrifice. Something had to die for him to cover them. And he covered them with skins after that. He's our covering. He's been our covering the whole time. Remember those that were first invited? They had other things to do. They had to go to this business or do that business. Hey, the game is on. You remember? They have other things of more concern to them than God's kingdom and to do his will. If you remember what my verses are, my life verses are Matthew 7:21 to 7:23. This reminded me of that because in Matthew 7:23, he says, I never knew you. Depart from me. We can act and play, but do we have actually living in it? Are we walking in it? So we get to see the result of him getting everybody in, and some come with improper clothing. Now the clothing needed was the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That was their covering. He invited everyone out of every tribe, people, and nation that he purchased with his own blood. This is a calling then to all the people that would come to the wedding feast, to come to heaven. It's through Jesus Christ. There's no other way. I just thought, it's like, can you imagine closing your eyes and entering into eternity, and you meet up with Christ, and he tells you, where's your suit? That would be a horrible thing, right? Paul the Apostle on Mars Hill, I don't have it up on the screen, but Paul the Apostle on Mars Hill is in Acts 17, verses 32 to 34. You can look it up. We read there that there were some different responses. Paul the Apostle was preaching the gospel, and he got responses from the gospel that he was preaching. And it is that some mocked the preaching, some hesitated and said, we'll hear you again, or they delayed. But then there was those that actually believed and say, I'm gonna walk in Christ. I'm gonna live in Christ. We see this happening in this parable. We see again a mockery of the indifference. Some people delaying, other people, things got people to do, but then there was some that actually believed. That's why he says, many are called, few are chosen. Many are gathered up, but few are chosen, because he's gonna know who's chosen because of his son. That's the mark. Play Store, you know what was it, Play Store? Andy under the foot. Toy Story. What did I say? I'm a little foggy this morning. Play Story, Toy Story. I love the movies. But if you don't have Jesus Christ, you won't get in. I believe you and I had a privilege of hearing this message this morning. But the question remains to us this morning. The same question. Where do we stand with what's been said? You've been invited, but will you come? Will you be there at the feast? Or is it important somewhere else? You know, it starts by surrendering of the will of us doing what we want to do and how we're going to do it. And it's not us doing the thing. Let me share with you. It's not about works. It's not about I need to do this and I do that. You need to be led by the Holy Spirit that he allows you to do these different things. He'll curve the time. He'll carve out the day. He'll do his work if you trust him. He'll provide. A lot of people work. I can't come to church because I work and I work and I work because I can't make ends meet. If you would put God first, seek kingdom first, then you would see he would open up the doors for you to serve him in the way he should. We get so caught up in these other things that we forget about him. We put him secondary, so we are secondary. You put him first, he's going to put you first, and he's going to blow your mind. I can guarantee you that. But we have to make a decision. You know, Joshua, towards the end of his life, he gathered all the people together, and he told them this, and it's out of Joshua 24:15, the very famous verse. And he said this, he told the people around him at his deathbed, and if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your father served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in those whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You know that indecision is one of the most fatal errors when you don't make a decision. That's a fatal error when you wait. He says today is the day of salvation, not any other. Each one of us personally has a RSVP. And I know that we've heard it. I know that a lot of you are living in that and following in that. You filled out the invitation. You're just waiting for him to call you. I think we're all waiting for that time that he calls us. To be absent from this body, to be present with the Lord, I can't wait. As I get to see this body breaking down, you know, I woke up last week and up with a bad limp, and something happened to my knee, and I'm like, what did I do in my sleep that I broke myself? It's just getting bad. But I can't wait to be out of the messes that I see in this world unfolding. I think it's taken too much of my life. And I just can't wait to, I think some of us were talking not too long ago, can you imagine a life that you don't have the draw to sin anymore? To do those propensities to want to sin. I can't wait for that because I mess up and I blow up many times. I just can't wait to a point where I don't have to deal with that anymore.
Jesus is calling. Oh, come. Lay your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
We're going to do the song a little different than we normally do. We have a drummer boy, so we're going to do this song just a little bit different.
See a miracle.
God, we believe for it. Move the immovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe.